Good day to you all. In this video we are going to look at this circuit. So we are still working with the capacitive way, but now I'm going to show you what happens when we replace it, our LED, like here, with a capacitor, and we only use the LED over here. So that diode is going away. But of course, because the LED is also a diode, we create a positive over here on the capacitor. And we are now going to see what happens in this situation. So we can see that we start at 0 volts. When I now put my signal on, then we can see that over here at the multimeter, the capacitor over here, which is this capacitor in the schematic, is charged up to 42 volts, even if our battery supply is only 12 volts. Now, first I thought, okay, maybe the gate driver or so is amplifying the amplitude, but that is not the case. So when we look at the scope over there, then we can see the signal that I have measured previously, because it's now at stop in one cycle that I have in memory. So the gray line over here that you see is the pulse that is created when we are just connecting the gate driver output directly to the signal generator, to the oscilloscope, excuse me. So the yellow line is the one that is created when I'm measuring over here in the circuit. So when I measure just in front of the capacitor after the gate driver output. Now, because I didn't want to interfere with the circuit, the probe connection is not connected at the moment, and we are first going to see what happens to our LEDs. So I'm going to get some more difference. So now you can see that when we are charging the capacitor, so we are still at the 40 volts, then the LED on the side of the input gives more of light than what is in series with our capacitor. Now when I disconnect that capacitor, and I connect directly to the LED, we immediately see a switch. So now the output LED is going on very much brighter than our input LED, but the input LED on this side is still burning. So going to remove it back. And as you can see, when I leave it open, even in that case, we only have the diode going from this capacitor over here. So we are now looking exactly as it is on the drawing over here. So the capacitor over here is going to this diode, to the other capacitor. And that's the only connection that is active at the moment. And you can see that we have an inverse flow of current on the input side, meaning we have current flow over here in this branch, while we are putting in a positive pulse of 12 volts in reference to the ground connection over here. Now there is no earth ground connection in this situation, because I'm using a battery and the signal generator is powered by a power bank over there. So going to zoom out again. You can see at the current that we are, even in this case, drawing some current. I will connect the LED so you can see the difference. So now the output LED is connected. And now we are back. And when we charge the capacitor, then we see that there is no change, so I will zoom in. So what is the difference that I'm going to do? So now I have over here this connection that the capacitor is charging. And we see that this LED if I can turn it more to the camera, is slightly on. Now we are going to watch at the meter over here. So when I now loosen the output, then we see that there is just a slight change in current. So now we are going to watch at the pulses. So going to set my scope back in run. First, I'm going to show you the direct output of the signal generator. So going to connect the positive, going to remove it from here and directly to the scope. And as you can see, that is our pulse that we are momentarily putting into the circuit. Okay, so that we can have as a comparison. Now for people who are saying maybe it's because of you place a load on there, which could be possible of course. So therefore I'm going to connect this LED. So minus. And I'm going to connect it directly to the gate driver output. And you are going to watch the signal on the scope. Like that. So now you can see I have an LED of 3 watts lighting up on the output of the gate driver. And as you can see, there is not much difference. Just at the end of the pulse, there is a slight uprise over here compared to what we have when there is no load connected. So that is also not the problem or the cause of the amplification. So at the moment I'm thinking that it's the resonance, but for that I have another problem. So in comparison with resonance with the inductive, and I'm going to show you the pulses so we can it's more clearly what I mean. So I'm going to put it a little bit higher, like that. Going to stop it back so that it's stable for what I want to explain. So I will show you, so when I put it in run, you can see it stays the same, but we slightly have some, with the triggering, some differences. So therefore I put it on single. Now in comparison with the inductive part, when we have the oscillations, then the moment our pulse length is too long, we are influencing the output in a negative way. But over here, in this situation, I'm helping to keep the oscillations longer active. And I will show you what I mean by that. So if I am running now, and I'm going to go to a slightly higher setting so that you can see the difference. So when we now change the frequency over here, so I'm now going to lower to 20 hertz, so that 20 kilohertz, excuse me. I'm going to put it back in the middle. So we have gone to a lower frequency, even the half of what we have before, and you can see that we are still having the same output but on a longer time. Now I'm at 10 kilohertz. Now there are frequencies that are better of course than other, but the major difference is that when we should do that with the inductive part of the free oscillations, then we can see that when the pulse is length is too long, that we are dampening the circuit. And in this case, they all stay the same, and the first is going in a, it's, you can call it a trumpet-like wave because it's growing, But I'm not exactly sure that we may call it a trumpet wave because it ends over here and it stays on that level. Now we have changed the frequency, but I can also change the duty cycle. So going back to 30 kilohertz, put it more to the middle. So now I'm going to change duty cycle. So we are now at 9.6%. At 17. And when we go higher, we are slightly dimming. So we are now at 30%. So we are now at 50%, but we still have amplitude. It's lower than the 10. So when we lower the input, we have higher output. But the thing is that the bandwidth of what we are having is much greater than with the inductive. Because with the inductive, we didn't have that much bandwidth to change frequency and or duty cycle to have major influence on the signal. And I can go here from 10 kHz to 40 kHz. There is a difference, but not that great like with the inductive part. So I can also go even to higher frequencies. So I'm going to start with 100 kHz. So this is 130. Going to lower it to 100 kHz. Then we go to 200 kHz. So now we are in a lower output, 300, 400, 500, 600, 700, 8, 9, 10, 1 megahertz. This is 2 megahertz. Now there is a slight change with the previous experiments that I have done. So I'm going to disconnect the output LED completely so that we only have the input and the diode. So you can see the input LED is it's bright. It's not completely full brightness, but it's bright. And we are using more current than we have before. But the gate driver above 2 megahertz is not so good, so at 1.9 megahertz the output LED is at its best brightness. Going to lower it again. Now we are going up, so the lower we go in frequency, the better we have, and the longer we can have the oscillations going. I'm going to move this back to there. So that you can see that the time that we have the possibility to have oscillations is longer. So this is, we have gone from 50 to 40 kilohertz, 30 kilohertz. And you can see that we have longer oscillations. Now the oscillations are around 8 megahertz. So I will take a measurement, cursor, time. Put it on single so it's stable. So we are at 7.8 megahertz, just as is measured over here, so that we are sure of that. So we are giving 30 kilohertz pulses and we are ending up with 8 megahertz oscillations. And the lower the frequency we have, the longer the oscillations are there. So we are now at 20 kilohertz, 10 kilohertz. I need to go change my time setting so you will be able to see it on one screen. But you can see every time I add, I'm taking a longer time that oscillations are there. Which would not be the case with the inductive. Because they would have been very much dampened. So we are at 4 kilohertz, 3, 2, and you can see I can keep the oscillations much longer, 1 kilohertz. Also look at the amplitude, it's not changing, or not that much, because if we measure on capacitor, that then we can see a slight voltage difference. So going to move it a little bit further to there. So as you can see, we have now a longer period of time. If we measure it, cursor. I'm going to put it on single so that it's still. Now we are going to change the other. Cannot go faster with the knob because it doesn't react when I go too fast. So we are now at a time span of 60 microseconds. Going to run again. So you can see, as long as we keep the pulse alive, we have those oscillations. Now, I also tried to do it with just DC, but that didn't work. It needs to have the switching. I guess that is all the things that for the moment that I wanted to show. So we have the measurements of the pulses, we have the capacitor. So thank you for watching and hope to see you in the next video.